Hello, and welcome to A Seat at the Table. I'm Deneen Milner.
I'm Christine White, and today we're talking about colorism in the Black community.
And I'm Monica Pearson. Tensions between light-skinned and dark-skinned women started during slavery.
And they're still playing out today. Here's an example from Dear White People.
Imagine the reaction if your divisive revolutionary drivel were coming from the mouth of a real sister.
A real sister?
You get away with murder because you look more like them than I do. That's your light skin privilege. Until you acknowledge that, shut the f*** up about who's woke or not.
She had a point.
Real.
As we sit here,
light-skinned people can't be woke.
I don't know any light-skinned person more woke than you.
Exactly.
I really do not.
Yes, but that might be a function of the fact that I grew up being called yellow girl.
You know, like, you tell me your stories about the way that people came for you about your color, and it just blows my mind because all, you know, what we go by is our own experiences, right? Mm-hmm. And what I remember is all of the ways that I was told that this was wrong. And it never occurred to me that you go through similar things just from a different perspective. Like, what were some of the things that you heard when you were growing up?
Oh, it ran the gamut. I think that it comes from this tension that was created purposefully among people of color, Black women, Black men as well. And it just sort of trickled down. So I had a girlfriend, good girlfriend to this day, but she called me piss colored every morning on the way to school.
But you know, it started during slavery. Now remember, it started during slavery. So when the massa of the house would breed with a Black woman, the child that was born, if it was more fair, then was taken to the house to work in the house because it was more acceptable. The darker skin stayed out in the field. Mm-hmm. And so there was this price paid in many ways, but then you became extra valuable because you looked more like what was acceptable for in the house. Now, you were called piss colored. I had a cousin who loved me dearly, older man, who used to look at me and say, it's a good thing you're so smart because you're so Black. I'm the darkest person in my family. I used to hear, the black of the berry, the sweet of the juice. You get too Black, you ain't no use. I can remember all of not being able to wear. I think that's why I wear bright colors all the time now. Because as a child, my mother dressed me in navy blue, in beige, in Black. I never wore a bright color until I was older. And my mother was your complexion. And when I asked her why, and I know she loved me, she would say, well, honey, you can't wear Black, you know, bright colors. You're too Black. Mm-hmm. Or drinking a cup of coffee. You drink too much coffee,
it's just gonna make you Black. Right. Don't go swimming in a pool because the pool will make you Black. Stay out of the sun because the sun will make you Black. As if something is wrong with being Black.
But that's because people who were fairer got more opportunities in the early days. Because they look more like the people who were in control.
Right. And then, you know, the issue becomes between you and me,
right?
So I'm looking at you, and I'm looking at you with a side eye, thinking that you think you're better than me because you're lighter.
Oh, I got that all day long. I always, for some reason, thought I was better than everybody else, but I never understood why. And I mean, I think that, you know, we have a lot of healing to do in the Black community, but we have to, it starts with understanding that it was intentional, that there was some value in light-skinned people and dark-skinned people. Well, first of all, there's value in Black people not talking, not getting along, period, right? And so then if there was a group of people that was treated better, then that would keep us from really realizing who was really doing harm to us.
Right.
I mean, but it's the same thing. It's the same strategy that rich white landowners used when there were poor white people and poor Black people.
Yes.
They separated them according to color so that they wouldn't revolt against the rich landowners who were taking advantage of them both. And so this is an experience that we've had, you know, that's been very entrenched in everything we've done. And if we don't appreciate that it was intentionally imposed upon us, then we begin to think that we're hateful people or that we can't work together or that we can't love each other, which is really problematic. And of course, it affects the way we see ourselves.
Absolutely.
But take a look at what has happened in many years ago. You know, Black mothers would say to their sons, you want to marry a light girl because any babies you would have, they'll be better off. And in some ways, you still see that. If you look at the music
in
videos,
a lot of ways,
you see nothing but light-skinned, long-haired girls, except if they're strippers.
And even when they're strippers.
Listen, okay, I grew up in Long Island, New York, and it was almost a crime to be chocolate.
Oh, yeah.
It was a crime. You know, my self-esteem was so low from being in a place where body image and color in particular, skin color, was every black male was looking for either a, you know, Latina girl or, you know, the prize possession was the white girl. But if you couldn't have either one of those, the light-skinned girl would do. But never, ever the dark girl. Never.
Yeah.
And that was hurtful. And I don't know that brothers are like that as much today. I don't...
Oh, no. I mean, I just feel like every celebrity, if they don't have... If it's not a white girl, they are with... fair girls.
That's true.
And I think that there's something to that, unless, of course, she's, like, famous or something, and has a lot of money.
And I'm not going to use his name, but the one comedian whose wife, very brown skin, they have two children, and then he leaves her to marry a very tall, light-skinned girl, and now...
With green eyes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. What is that about, though? I'm
trying to figure out who y'all talking about.
But the truth of the matter is, I wonder if... Black men, I mean, they're quick to understand that there has been some sort of oppressive force on them.
Yes.
But I wonder if they see their choices as something that was imposed upon them, that their ideals for what beauty is something that came as a result of living in an oppressive society that said the color of your mama mm-hmm. is not beautiful.
Right.
I just don't understand.
But they'll be the first ones to say, I'm just in love, and who are you to question, you know, my love and my affection for this woman. And it's just like, now, come on, bruh. All of y'all can't be, you know, just in love without all of the other connotations.
But what happens then is that we as black women, in some instances, you know, young women who are my complexion, instead of loving their fro and loving their skin, they'll get a hair weave down to here because some brother has told them,
right,
I like long hair.
Right. And it's a standard of beauty that we've sort of imposed upon everyone in America. I mean, everyone really all over the world. I wonder, though, if, you know, Beyonce would have been as famous as she is if she wasn't fair.
Well, we know that answer. Look at Destiny's Child, you know, and Beyonce and Kelly.
But you
there's some more.
I don't know.
You know what my mother used to say about Destiny's Child? My mom was alive. It's so funny. She would say, that Beyonce, I don't know. That Kelly is way prettier. And that meant so much to me.
Yeah.
For my mother to look at them after, you know, all these years of growing up and feeling like something was wrong with this.
Right.
For my mother to say Kelly was prettier than Beyonce was something for me.
Well,
it really was.
You know what? Colorism really boils down to self-hate, and this clip says it perfectly.
But you see, with me, there is no confusion. People take one look at my skin and they assume that I'm poor or uneducated or ratchet. So yeah, I tone it down, make myself more palatable, join a sorority. What's so wrong with that?
Everything.
Dear white people, you made me hate myself as a kid. So now I hate you, and that's my secret shame.
I mean, I wonder, is there a survival mechanism that says that if you blend in better, if you don't revolt against the system, if you are amenable, that you'll get ahead in life?
Well, you both are too young, but I can remember a time when even to get into certain churches, and that's what's scary, African-American churches, when they used to vote you in, they would have a paper bag. And if you were darker than that paper bag, then they would suggest you go somewhere else.
To go to church?
Oh, yeah. There were churches here in Atlanta that used to do the paper bag test. They would do it very quietly and very nicely, but you were just, you know, just a little bit too dark. You weren't allowed to join.
That doesn't even make any sense to me.
But you've got to remember, you wanted to keep, and it's not right, but they wanted to keep a certain look for that congregation.
Why?
Who was looking?
But remember, back in the old days, and this is hard for you all to understand, you know, if you're light, you're all right. If you're brown, stick around. If you're black, stay back. And because that was the way for upward mobility, that you were more acceptable if you looked like the majority race. It's not fair, it's not right, but that's the way it was. Now, it shouldn't have to be that way now, but in some instances it is. I'm sure there are people who want to date your daughter because of not only what you do, but because she's light-skinned with long hair.
Yeah, I mean, I have had experiences with men where it becomes clear over time that they have a preference for light-skinned women. And it's actually a turnoff. I don't take it as a compliment. Now, I don't know. It's weird because, you know, they also may like my neck or they might think my toes are pretty. But when they say, get over here with that light skin,
nope.
I'm completely turned off.
Nope.
Like, now they could say, oh, those cheeks, look at that baby. But the minute that they say light skin, I'm completely turned off. Because I have a sister who's brown, and we were always sort of not pitted against each other, but it was our complexion was evident in how people talked about us all the time. And, even as a child, I think I internalized this whole racial stigma. My dad was dark, my mom was light, my sister's dark, I'm light, and I felt almost like I had to protect them. Like there was some sort of that I could create some barrier to protect them. I mean, I don't know where it came from, but that's sort of how I felt as a child. So when a man says something to me like, I like them light.
No.
That sounds so crazy and ignorant.
No.
Like, I don't even know what to do with that. Like,
And it's funny because, I have a cousin who is darker than me. She's gorgeous. And she created this website specifically for dark-skinned women so that they could see the makeup. She's really into makeup, the makeup that they can use for their complexions. And she once wrote a piece about how she hates when people call her chocolate or dark-skinned. She's like, I'm brown, I'm me,
right.
I'm Mel.
Like, dark relative to what?
Right, exactly. Or you're pretty for a black girl.
Oh, I hate
that. Hear that all the time.
Or you're smart for a black girl.
For a black girl.
Or you dress well for a black girl. I didn't think a black girl could wear that color.
Right. Absolutely. Wow. And so, coming from growing up in a place where having dark skin, it feels good when someone says, oh, you're so chocolate and fine. Mm-hmm. Yes, I am. And I finally recognize it.
Okay, well, we got to take a break. But when we come back from bleaching to tanning, the extremes black women go through to change their complexion.
If you have a rat's nest on top of your head with a comb sticking out of it, running around campus trying to be Miss Blackity Black Black.
I wanted an avant-garde look, like Solange. Something that says I'm woke, but I'll also kick your ass in an elevator.
Dear white people, let me tell you about yourselves when I don't even know who the hell I am.
And I started to hate my complexion. So what I started doing was tanning a lot. And over the years of excessive tanning, I developed skin damage called melasma, which is here on my forehead. I also have dark spots above my lips. And as a result, I now have to use expensive laser treatment and bleaching creams to fade away the dark spots. I find it ironic that now, in hindsight, trying to be accepted to change my complexion with excessive tanning, that I now have to seek therapy to change the complexion of my skin.
Welcome back to A Seat at the Table.
She needs therapy.
She needs therapy.
And maybe the people she was trying to fit in with aren't the people she needs to try to fit in with.
But she has low self-esteem if she's got to spend that much time. But how many of our young people are... bleaching cream, whatever drugstore you go to, it is there.
Right.
And oftentimes you see us buying it. Why?
And this is a global concern, right?
Yes.
It's like you go to Asia and there are women in Asia who are doing this. There are women in Africa who are doing it. How are you doing this in Africa with all them chocolate folks?
But the question is, what does it look like when you're sitting at the table at, let's say, Vogue or Mademoiselle or one of these magazines and we say, you know what? She's looking a little dark. Let's lighten her skin up
and
on the cover.
And they've done that.
Why would they do that?
They've done it to Beyonce.
What's the point? They do it all the time, but why?
Look at that. There's a perfect example.
Oh, she's too dark. Yeah, let's just,
And she was perfect the way she was.
Absolutely.
Well, whose call was that? And why are they still in that position? I mean, it's systemic. This is what we talk about when we talk about systemic racism.
Right.
Systemic colorism.
Well, speaking as a former magazine journalist, I can tell you that it's very rare that you have anyone who looks like any of us, light-skinned, dark-skinned, or otherwise, sitting in those editorial offices helping to make those decisions. And so what you're going to look at as beautiful is what looks like you. So what you're seeing on the cover of those magazines is completely reflected at that editorial meeting.
But unless you're exotic. Now, if you're like Lupita Nyong'o and you become very famous as an actress, then of course they want you to be this beautiful, dark brown, exotic woman. But again,
she's treated as an exception.
She's an exception. Iman was the same way. When she came out with her whole makeup line, they made up this whole story about how they found her, you know, in the wilds of Africa.
It wasn't true at all.
Exactly.
Yeah, but it wasn't true at all. But ridiculous. The point is that you change who we are.
Right.
I even remember that President Obama was on one of the national magazines and they darkened him.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, this man is a white mother.
I've also heard of them lightening him. So just depending on the audience or depending on...
Or how sinister they want him to look.
Right.
Oh, let's talk about sinister with O.J. Simpson being on the cover of Time magazine and them making sure that he was super, super dark because, you know, criminal.
Well, I mean, I read on Facebook that they've been doing that to cartoon characters.
Yes.
The guy was saying, stop making cartoon characters darker because it... perpetuates this idea that somehow brown is evil, which is ridiculous.
I mean, it's so deep. Think about camera equipment, specifically film. Now, we all take our film, you know, our camera, our phones now and take, but we used to use film, right?
Yes.
And the film was always calibrated specifically to capture your skin and the skin of white folks, and we would literally disappear into the background. So when you're thinking about what shows up on the cover of the magazines, what shows up in those editorial images of models and fashion magazines and such, all of it is by design. It's systemic.
And it makes you wonder why people do certain things. Now, Michael Jackson started out with vitiligo, which is the lightening of the skin. And you have a choice, because my daughter had vitiligo. You have a choice of bringing back your natural skin color. There are many processes. But you can also lighten your skin. In my daughter's case, it was a case of putting this medicine on. They would put her in a light box and her beautiful brown came back. Mm. But in Michael Jackson's case, he chose to go the other way and turn his skin whiter. Because again, that means more acceptance. But again, that's also self-hate.
Right, absolutely.
It causes incredible psychological damage. I can't imagine that the people who are in these magazine offices who are turning people darker to make them look sinister or lightening up the color of a brown person's skin to make them look more attractive or more appealing to their audience don't understand the damage that they're doing, the psychological damage, the messages that they're sending to young children.
It's about making money. Right. It's not about messages. It's about making money.
Well, there are more people on this earth that are brown than there are that are white. So if you want to make money, then you should think about how you can capture that audience.
Which the makeup industry
is finally
getting a handle on, right? Because how long have we gone without being able to find shades to match our skin? And so finally, these companies are coming out and understanding we come in like 11 shades of brown, right? And we're going to actually put it in the store so that this audience of people can find it, which is, you know,
in the old days, you only had Ebony magazine and their fashion fair.
Right.
That was the line.
Right.
Then there was Opal, I think it was,
and Black Opal.
Mm-hmm. And then Iman came along. And now you've got, you know, Queen Latifah with a beautiful makeup line for CoverGirl.
Right.
Lancome, again, has their line. Almost everybody now is making colors, not only for African-American skin, they're realizing the Latino women fall into that category, as well as Asian women.
Absolutely.
But it's only because it made good, as you said, business sense.
Yeah.
It was an untapped market. And now everybody has a black someone representing their line of cosmetics because it makes money.
Right.
But still, I see people in the stores buying makeup that is too light for their skin tone because they want to be lighter.
Yeah, I don't get it. I mean, I think that there are lots of reasons why we change our face. We might inject our lips, or we may try to, you know, make our face look more Kardashian or whatever, but higher cheekbones, I don't know, less bags under our eyes. And so there are things that I think that we all struggle with, but the color piece is very specific. I mean, yes. there's something different about feeling like you are bad because of the color of your skin.
What about little Kim?
Child.
She used to be
she
so
was
cute.
Gorgeous.
She was gorgeous. She was so
such
cute.
A cutie pie.
And for whatever
now,
reason.
She looks like a lion.
But who was telling her she looked bad? Maybe it's just being in the media so much, and I don't know.
It's
being in the
world. It's being a part of the entertainment culture. It's a part of being in the space where light is right, period.
Yeah.
That's
and
what
you
that
represent
is.
A lot of entertainers. What do you tell young women who say, well, do you think I should do this? Do you think I should do that?
I don't know. I actually deal with more men who tend to have sort of, there is sort of a colorism issue with men as well. Like, they want to look dark because they want to look hard.
Ah.
And, like, you know, the fair guys have to prove, they have to overprove their blackness. Hmm. They have to overprove their masculinity. So there is this association with being sort of black and male, being dark and strong. I mean, wow. I don't know.
But Taye Diggs, with his chocolate beautiful
oh,
self,
yes.
talked a lot about how when he was younger, he hated his skin color and that he knew he was going to grow up and marry, you know, probably a white woman or someone extremely fair because he wanted his children to look a certain way. And he's very honest and open about it and actually wrote a couple of really beautiful children's books to talk about, you know, what it means to be chocolate and to finally love the skin that you're in, which I love that. You know, a big part of what I wanted to do with my daughters, and they're both, one is lighter and one is super chocolate. And I had to check my family first and make sure that you don't treat one different
right.
from the other because one is light and one is dark. And then I had to hone in on Chocolate Dewdrop and make sure that she understands that she is absolutely gorgeous. Let's go sit out in this sun. Mm-hmm. Let's go play in this water.
But see, it's different, I think, for men. Do you find that men have issues? Like, I happen to love Kevin Garnett.
Mm-hmm.
For reasons I don't even know. I think part of it has to do with the fact that he is so beautifully brown.
Right.
And I wonder if that makes me a colorist, number one. But
maybe you just like his body.
Yeah, there are some other things.
There are some other things, too, though.
But, I mean, you know, it doesn't seem like they have the same issues
it doesn't
with
seem
attractiveness.
Like, it doesn't seem like they do because, you know, maybe personally we don't really have a preference. But you talk to some brothers and they will tell you
oh, they have
that
a
they
preference.
Have issues.
Yeah.
No, that they have issues, too, with dealing yeah. with, you know, their own colors and sort of being comfortable in the skin.
And some women have issues with they'll say, I only want to date a chocolate brother.
Right.
Because he reminds me of a thug. You know, you have those women who are into thugs.
Right.
You know, but
so what
that's
is this,
reality.
What is the connection between chocolate and thug? That's what I want to know.
Well, you
I
know,
have no idea.
Black and criminal. What?
Ooh.
I mean, black and wrong. Black is get back. You know, that's what it is.
Never thought
the darker
that.
You are, the more sinister you are and as a man, and that is manly, right? But not for us. It's not
for
beautiful.
Us. No.
Yeah. That's awful.
Well, you know, this has been a good conversation. But I wonder now how many people are going to be checking their family background to see did they marry for love or marry for color.
Whoop. Well, that's a good question. I do know that my father dates and has, you know, my mother was fair, his new wife is fair, and it does kind of make me give him the side eye. And I, you know, I know that he loves black women, but what is the, there's a pattern
right.
we're seeing here.
Right.
And I wonder if, you know, they could be more introspective about that. I think they should.
Good luck
at his
with that.
Age.
Good luck with that. It's not going to happen.
It ain't going to happen.
No.
Well, we have to go, but the conversation doesn't end here.
Share your thoughts with us on social media.
We're on Twitter, Facebook, Snapchat, Instagram, and Pinterest at ASATTTV.
Thanks for joining us for A Seat at the Table. And in the words of Shirley Chisholm, if they don't give you a seat at the table,
bring a folding chair.
Yes, ma'am.
Brown skin, you know I love your brown skin. begins. I can't tell where mine is. Brown skin up against my brown skin. Need some every now and then. Brown skin.